It is apparent that Vancouver 2010 has a wide range of projects in place to ensure a grassroots sporting legacy. Yet the Organising Committee and the International Olympic Committee have clearly defined objectives for legacy and sustainability that extend beyond sport, including social, economic, and environmental goals. Are these objectives realistic? When the Olympic movement adopted its sustainability guidelines set out in Agenda 21, they committed to playing an active part in the sustainable development of our planet. In order to achieve its targets, the Olympic movement and its stakeholders are working to ensure better socio-economic conditions, preservation of the environment, and efficient use of natural resources.
The IOC Agenda 21 also mentioned social interests and opportunities for people that don't usually benefit from large mega events. Social inclusion and considering the needs and interests of people really stems from two areas. One has been the First Nation communities whose territories the Games will occur on, as well as people in large cities.
Mark Hetherington has been involved in setting up a community-based training program that will play an active role at the Games.
This is the fabrication shop where we're building all the small wooden products that Vanok needs to run the Olympics. We're also running a training school for first-year carpenters, and we partnered with three local community organizations to achieve that.
Rather than hiring experienced carpenters or contracting out, we thought we'd create our own fabrication shop and create a community training program inside it.
There are people that are literally living on the streets, and through the help of these community organizations, we've changed their lives. They're getting paid a wage. You notice they start showing up in cleaner clothes, new clothes. They bring lunch, which they didn't have before. You know, it's amazing.
Savannah Sandy is one person who is benefiting from the fabrication shop.
She's a single mom, and she's now in her sixth week. And already, Kevin, our instructor, has got her on the table saw. He's got her using the router. He's confident that she's safe on all the tools. And she's really loving it.
We're learning a lot, like, in a lot of different sections. Like, we're building our own projects, like toolboxes and sawhorses, as well as learning how to make concrete forms and footings. And then we're also making a lot of the projects, the wooden objects for the Olympics as well. It's good to have a lot of skills like that. It opens a lot of doors to other things.
In a small flower shop in Vancouver, the novel approach of selecting businesses that will give back to society is further validated. Margita Schultz and June Strandberg have been selected to fulfill an important role at the Games.
We're actually making the victory bouquets, the bouquets that are presented to every athlete. We actually train women that are marginalized, women coming from prison, women at risk, just a whole group of women that need to be moving on with their life. And this opportunity that's come along for us, for them, is just an absolute unbelievable thing. It's like a gold medal for them.
There has also been considerable emphasis on the Games leaving a legacy for the four host First Nations. It is seen as a chance for them to showcase their culture to the world and to provide economic opportunities for their people.
The Games are taking place within the traditional and shared traditional territories of four nations. And we have three different languages, we have different customs and practices. But what we've done is that we haven't always worked together, but the Games has really brought us together. There have been so many entrepreneurs and businesses, Aboriginal, that have been involved in the Games. Over $53 million in contracts have gone to Aboriginal people. Over 100 businesses, you know, have participated in that program.
RBV is one such First Nations company. Anticipating the construction needs of the Winter Games, the Lilwat Nation partnered with an established local company to form Resource Business Ventures, and are using the Games to grow skills and experience that will be an enduring legacy. New Haven is a construction business principally owned by the Squamish Nation. New Haven has focused on doing community facilities, schools, recreation centers, gymnasiums, as well as work on the Olympic site. They have also built the Squamish Lilwat Cultural Center that celebrates the joint history of the Squamish and Lilwat First Nations by showcasing their culture.
Whistler is actually the overlapping territory of both the Squamish and Leetwets. At one time, this was a traditional area where if we intermarried with each other, the people would live here.
Great efforts have also been made to secure strong Aboriginal input into the Cultural Olympiad. Connie Watts will be managing the new Aboriginal Art at Venues program.
There's two different types of works, including a four-host First Nations welcome work, which is where it's oriented to welcome the world to their traditional territories.
We've been given an opportunity to create pieces, welcoming pieces, pieces that show off our culture on our own territory, that where some of the Olympic venues are. So I've created a piece at Callahan Valley, the Nordic Day Lodge. It's sort of an old story that deals with our origins of the salmon and how we treat the waterways that come down through that valley into the Squamish Valley.
The Richmond Speed Skating Oval is one of the flagship structures for the event and provides an intriguing example of art meeting sustainable architecture. The ducts for collecting and recycling the rainwater from the roof are pieces of Coast Salish art.
The works at the Richmond Oval, the Susan Point pieces, were initiated from Richmond. It was the first Aboriginal art project that occurred within one of the venues, and it was amazing.
The theme of the overall project represents the river. The Richmond Oval itself is situated in the middle arm of the Fraser River. I incorporated the salmon, which is something that our people used to fish in that area for, and it was a sustenance for the people at that time, and it also is a symbol of wealth. And I also incorporated the heron or crane, which is the bird of the city of Richmond. And on the tops, I've also incorporated like the raven, which is, you know, a bird that you always see in like native art or Coast Salish art.
These ducts are a visual affirmation of what Vancouver and the International Olympic Committee are trying to achieve, with First Nations Indigenous art built into the venue to meet a sustainable environmental purpose.